Hello and welcome everyone to Phil 1013, Philosophy and Humour. This short introductory video is going to present to you the course outline, the course content, and the academic requirements that students are always interested in knowing. It's pretty straightforward, so we're going to get to it in just a couple of minutes. The first thing I'd like to do is to introduce myself. My name is Edward Matthews. I have an honors in film theory production, an MA in social and political thought, and a PhD in philosophy. So that makes me a perfect candidate to teach a course on comedy and humor. So there you go. Now, typically, you find me in room A2003, which is the School of Languages and Liberal Studies. But until further notice, you can contact me online at the following email address, ematthews@fanshawonline.ca. And there it is right there, and is also available for you to see if you forget on the first page of the FOL page when you go into, you look to your content. So as I mentioned, my academic background is fairly varied. I have a background in social and political thought, a sort of an emphasis on continental philosophy, which is Western European philosophy rather than international or Asian philosophy or Islamic. Also have a very strong interest in social anthropology, women's studies, psychoanalysis, and linguistics and semiotics, which is the study of language. So that's kind of my background. Now, enough of me. What is this course about, and what are you alleged to walk away with when you're finished? Well, the vocational learning outcomes are pretty straightforward. The first one is to be able to define the idea of humor as criticism. Because as we will see throughout the course, a lot of humor is critical. It points out the differences between what something is versus what something should be. So there's a little bit of a moral content in most humor. Now, absurdist humor, surrealist humor, no, not so much. But certainly, generally speaking, humor does have a critical edge, right? It tends to punch up, right? To change things, to point out the absurdity of a situation, for example, people's behaviors, their way of thinking. So to define humor as critical is one of the ways in which we can explore that world. And that is very important. So that's kind of one main idea. In fact, if not the main idea. The second one is to look at different theories of humor. The superiority theory, the incongruity theory, the theory of play and carnival. These different ideas about humor explain to us how it functions. And how it functions in terms of our position in relation to the content, in relation to the speaker. Right? What is our relationship to the listener as we laugh at someone else? Right? What kind of humor is that? That doesn't punch up, does it? It's not critical. It's not helpful. So there are different types of humor, and those we're going to look at in the first half of the course before we have our midterm test. And then those different theories will help to inform the second half of the course and allow us to better understand the kinds of humor that we may like, that we may sort of gravitate towards. And now we can at least identify, we know what kind it is. Then we're going to talk about the differences between parody, which is making fun of something in a recognizable way. SNL skits are perfect ideas or representations of parody. Second City, if you ever watch SCTV as a kid, or your parents may have, and there's lots of it online on YouTube, parody and satire sort of overlap a fair bit. And that is a particular form of humor that works on recognition. It works on having an awareness of that particular culture, its social formations and social behaviors, its political systems, its religious systems even. And so parody and satire need to function in a recognizable way, in the sense that the listener needs to know what it is that's being made fun of. Otherwise, the humor really is lost. And this is why, internationally speaking, humor that is parodic or satiric from another country may not export very well. And that's not to say the joke isn't funny. It's just that we don't have the references that would allow us to understand the true nature of the joke, what it is that they're making fun of. But there are certainly various types of parody and satire around the world that function very specifically in that context. There's also the notion of slapstick, and slapstick is something that belongs for the most part to the silent film era in the teens and 20s. But there's certainly lots of slapstick humor that we see even today. Jackass, right? The series. That was a really good example of slapstick humor, but with almost a violent edge to it. Or not really satirical, but slapstick, yes, but sometimes nasty. And so the traditional idea of slapstick, as we saw in silent films, whether it's Laurel and Hardy or Keystone Cops, Charlie Chaplin, that kind of slapstick humor is certainly around, but it has evolved and changed over time, as any form of humor does and should. We'll also talk about carnival, the carnivalesque, right? The inverting of social norms, where high is low and what is illegal or irrational is good. So this is, of course, during a temporary period of time. And the carnival normally happens over a period of maybe a week or so, usually just before Lent. If you're a Christian or a Catholic, you'll understand the period just before Easter. Carnival kind of blends in with that social calendar, but we'll get to that. And then finally, the absurd. The absurd is a kind of humor that is very popular right now because individuals are trying very hard not to offend others. And also not to denigrate others and to laugh at another person's misfortune. So what happens now is the absurdity of something is a situation. And it can be a situation that everyone partakes in. Everyone recognizes it. Whether it's, renewing your license for your car or waiting in line to check out somewhere. And things can become absurd. And really, it doesn't matter who it is that is doing the absurd behavior. The nature of the joke isn't about the person. It's about their behavior. So absurdity is something that is, in this day and age, in a politically correct age, far safer to play with than the kinds of humor that we've seen, for example, in the 1970s, where everything was fair game and all kinds of different people were made fun of for all kinds of different reasons. Not to necessarily attach a value judgment, but sometimes there is a value judgment that is inherent in this kind of humor. And this is something we're going to look at in more detail towards the tail end of this course. Now, as you probably have picked up, you will notice that there are historical periods in humor. There are periods of time, we can go all the way back to the ancient Greeks and their idea of satire, much more filthy, much more lewd, much more bawdy, like B-A-W-D-Y, as opposed to B-O-D-Y. Much more rude, in fact, than what we have today. And so there are historical periods with humor, and we are in an historical period now, which is the postmodern period, where it's a different relationship that we have with others. It's one that we are more careful to consider before we start acting out loud and thinking out loud and trying to be funny. And comedians can still play within these perimeters. It just requires a little bit more work because you can't just take a cheap shot at someone anymore. So those historical periods we're going to take a look at. Now, number six, define the relationship between language, play, and humor. Now, obviously, all humor is based on some form of language. First of all, we need to understand that language. Whether it's English, or if you are an international student and English is your second, perhaps your third language, you have an advantage. You have an advantage in being able to speak two or three languages, or at least understand two or three languages. And the more intuitively you understand that language, the more you can play with it. You can play with words that sound the same, or words that when you say them out loud, sound the same, but it's spelt differently. So you're playing with language. You're being very flexible with words and the meaning of words. And quite often, what is considered incongruous humor or incongruity is based on these language games, right? The playing of language. Any kind of a sort of ad lib often is based on that. Goofy words like an alcoholiday. Right? It's a combination of two different words. So that's playing with language. And it is a form of humor that is very specific to the language that the listener understands and the speaker also understands. Because otherwise, if you don't understand what words mean, sometimes the humor can be lost. So the language that is being used and the degree to which the speaker understands and can manipulate that language tells us the degree to which they can be funny. And finally, the last one is to discuss the role of humor, laughter in a postmodern or a multicultural society. And this is the world, this is the historical period that we're facing today. And when I say facing, it sounds like it's something harsh. It isn't. It's just it's a different world. But in that different world, now we have different ideas we need to consider. The notion of empathy, the notion of consideration. We can still be funny, but we cannot turn around and just take a cheap shot at someone because it's a quick thing. It's kind of off the top of our heads. And as we will discuss and we'll see in one particular clip with Bill Maher using the N-word, for example, sometimes thinking off the top of your head gets you in a lot of trouble. So when we talk about humor, laughter in a postmodern or a multicultural society, this is the kind of humor that borders on the absurd. It may border on parody or slapstick, but it's not the kind of nasty humor that we were sort of used to, we'll say, back in the 1960s and 70s, where the people that were being made fun of were essentially silent, right? They were not silent because they took it, but because they had no way of talking back, or as we say, pushing back. So now we have ethnic comedians, we have many female comedians, very good ones. We have comedians who are also happen to be Muslim and are very self-aware. And in the tail end of the course, the last couple of weeks, we're going to look at some really good comedians who play with their identity, but do it in such a way that it's a kind of teachable moment. And this is part of the great joy of living in a multicultural society, where we can get these people to teach us, to educate us about what it's like to be one of them, but do it in a humorous way. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's a different style of humor, and it's a different historical period of humor. So these are the kinds of things we're going to be looking at. So the method of evaluation is fairly straightforward. This is sort of as a result of teaching this course now. I think this is my fifth or sixth time teaching it. And I put it together about three years ago. It's been very popular. And students really enjoy this part. And I know some of you are not big fans of writing because you're taking computer sciences or accounting or electrical, welding. It doesn't matter. But here's what I'd like you to consider. Part of the final grade will be to write four short written assignments. And I mean short. They're not 1500 page essays with, you know, two pages of citations. They're about 600 to 800 words. Now, if you type like I do, 600 to 800 words is about 2 to 2.5 pages. It's not huge, but each one is going to be worth 15% of your final mark. And we're going to talk about those in just a moment. So you're looking at, first of all, there are no sort of weekly quizzes. There are readings, yes, and the readings do bear upon the content of each of the modules, but you're going to be writing four short written assignments, approximately 600 to 800 words, each worth 15% of the final mark. There will also be two online tests. Now, typically they'd be taking place in class, but we don't have a class, but each one of those is worth 20% of the final mark. Now, if you add them up really quickly, it's 60-40. Now, is there a reason why that is? Well, for me, if you're like me, I really stress out over tests. So what I've done is I've put a little bit more emphasis on the written part of the course requirements or the academic requirements, because it gives students a chance to just sort of take a deep breath and just relax and just put their thoughts on paper. I would rather have you do that and take the time to shape something that you're really happy with, because you've got the time. Online tests or in class, it doesn't matter. You're writing under pressure. You're writing within a time frame. Sometimes you just go blank, right? You get a brain malfunction of some sort. So the reason why I've got it at 60-40 is so that you have a slightly better chance of doing work at home that is going to count for more percentage-wise with your overall mark. So that's essentially what's going on in terms of the requirements. So the reflection essays, we're just going to go into a little bit more detail here. So students will submit four subjective reflection essays, each centered on a topic discussed in class or in the textbook. The textbook contains sections entitled Pause and Reflect. which may be used as an initial guide for further thoughts. Now, what that means, and I actually had a student really panic over this a few years ago, even though in the book, and it's this in the book right here, right there, Philosophy of Humor, we'll talk about it in a moment. At the end of each of the little sections, there is either creative writing exercises or pause and reflect. You don't have to do those and do all of the, or answer all those questions. They're just there. But if you take a look at the reflection essay topics, you'll see that many of them do match up. So that's where I took many of them. There's a couple that are specific to other books that I looked at, but they are subjective. In other words, they are your thoughts, right? And I don't mean your thoughts as opposed to citations. They're truly your thoughts. What do you think of this material? Do you agree with the position that the that either I take in the classroom, or in this case online, that the book may take in relation to a particular type of humor, incongruous or superiority or relief humor or relief theories of humor? Does that make sense? Can you kind of work through it? Even if the essay is you trying to make sense of something, that's still an essay and it's still helpful. So I would like it to be subjective. You do not need to look for secondary sources. Okay, I cannot stress that enough. I want your thoughts. And not only that, but I want those to be reflections that you have come up with. Last year, I had a student in the music industry arts program who was also a lyricist. And the first time I read through his paper, I was noticing a lot of sort of what's called onomatopoeia. Right? Words that sound like the thing that they describe, like let's say snake, right? The word snake sounds like the thing. And this young man had a real gift for language. And I mentioned it after the first time in his feedback, and he kept on doing it. And finally I said, look, I look forward to reading your essays because clearly you're having fun with, as a lyricist, you're having fun with words. So it was like reading like a rap. All right. And everything flowed. There was a rhythm. There was a style. There was a rhyming scheme. It was brilliant. Now, you don't need to go that far. But this was someone that took this idea of subjective reflection and just kind of ran with it and had fun. So I leave it up to you how you wish to address these particular things. You can bring your own examples in. Although we don't look at the film Borat, for example, you can talk about Borat. You can write about a film that you like, and now maybe take a look at it with a new set of eyes and realize that, oh, okay, a lot of this type of humor would be called, you know, absurdist or slapstick or incongruous. I didn't know what that word meant before, but now I can see it sort of in action in this film. Then you go ahead and describe a couple of examples. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm looking for. So the textbook contains the sections called pause and reflect, but do not do those. You don't have to. But to carry on, so these written assignments can include informative scholarly research with in-text citations if you wish. That's all I'm going to say. You do not have to use secondary sources. Now, they can be taken either from the required textbook or from the PowerPoint slides. We'll talk a little bit more about this because the first is not even due till week four, so lots of time. But again, the overriding concern will be an intellectual reflection by yourself on your chosen topic. So that's really kind of the long and the short of it. So the required learning resource is this book here. There you go. The Philosophy of Humor by Paul McDonald. Came out in 2012. Very good book, very useful book. And we look at a lot of the things that are discussed in this book. You essentially read the whole thing. But as you can see, not really that big. There we go. It's about 130 pages. So not really a whole lot. And you have the entire term to read it. And you'll see each week as we look in the second half of the slides and also on the course information sheet, the breakdown, the weekly breakdown of the readings. Now, another book that I did use in putting together these slides is this book here. This one here, The Philosophy of Laughter and Humor, edited by John Morial. Very good and very useful book that basically collects lots and lots of short essays by a variety of different people under different topics. Traditional theories of laughter and humor, contemporary theories of laughter and humor, amusement and other mental states, and the ethics of laughter and humor. This becomes very important as we talk about postmodernism and multiculturalism. Another book that I use also by John Morial is this one here, Comedy, Tragedy, and Religion. As odd as that title may sound, those three topics, those three ideas have a lot of overlap. And we'll see that both very early in the course and then also throughout the course as we talk about the role of religion in humor, because there is one. There's also the role of tragedy in comedy, because there is one there as well, especially by way of contrast. And the last one is this short little book here, this little tiny thing, Matthew Bevis, Comedy, A Short Introduction. Looks really tiny, but super, super dense with information. Now, the last one I forgot to pick out of my library here is this one here. Trust me, though, I do own it. I forgot to pick it up. A book by Noel Carroll, Humor, A Very Short Introduction. Now, both this book and the Noel Carroll book come from the same series, Oxford University Press. Excellent, excellent books, but very, very dense. So they don't look like very much, and they're very short, 140 or so pages, but very dense with information. And we'll touch on some of Noel Carroll's ideas throughout the course, but he becomes particularly important towards the tail end, his ideas about multiculturalism. And this is what I mean when I say, when you read something, whether you agree or disagree with an author, just because ideas are presented and they might be presented in book form is not the gospel truth. You can disagree. You can dispute that position. You can turn around and support it with further evidence. That's the subjective reflection. And I'm hoping that this is the joy you will have in this course, is having a chance to sort of vent, if you wish, or to seriously think about something. And perhaps we're going to talk about something for the first time that you hadn't realized before, whether it's types of humor, because I mean, comedy is what we laugh at, but humor is how and why we laugh at it. So there is a distinction, even maybe just that distinction alone, or the difference between humor and laughter. I mean, humor and laughter are two different things. Laughter is a physiological response. You can be very nervous and agitated and laugh because it's a stress relief. And you can look at humor and not laugh. So they are connected and they're not connected, but there is a very interesting relationship between the two. So at this point now, what we typically do in the classroom is we will stop and I will, after presenting sort of an idea, I then will go with a short clip. So we're going to have a short look at a Monty Python skit called History of the Joke, which I thought in this particular case would be rather helpful.
Manifestation of the basic simple precipitation jest incurred, as will be seen from the demonstration, a disproportionate amount of internal risibility on the part of the operator. Secondary precipitation occurs when both protagonist and dupe are located indoors. It is true, however, that this has involved the development of a special piece of machinery. But it is still no more than a simple variation of primary precipitation. The opening up of the African continent revealed a vast new source of wealth for humorous exploitation. We are to see demonstrated how this was adapted to the basic precipitation jest. We now come on to a considerate... We now come on to a consideration of the more sophisticated transitive mode of japing, in which, as you will observe, the operator or inceptor remains totally unaware of the humorous implications of his action. First, we are to see the simple side swipe or whop. Hey! Thanks. Next, the side swipe and return. Hey, thanks. And now the double side swipe and return. Hey, Vance. Popular as this jest has always been, however, it cannot compare with the ribald connotations associated with the dispatch of an edible missile. First, the simple, straightforward, offensive deposit. Second, the simple sideways offensive deposit. Next, the simple surprise deposit. And now, the foul pie. Could we have new pies, please? Finally, we move on to the interesting but little known variant, nominally designated the three-course complex. But finally, we must not forget the enjoyment, the satisfaction, and the edification to be derived from the simple, straightforward, sideways, completely unexpected deposit.
Okay, so believe it or not, in that little 6-minute skit, there were many different styles of humor. Slapstick, first of all. There is the parody of the sort of Harvard educated lecturer talking about the various japes and the notion of the pie throwing contest. So there's a whole lot of things that are going on. Those are the kinds of things we're going to unpack. Hopefully I will not be as dull as boring as Graham Chapman. But the idea is that we're going to look at what makes things funny. Why? How does it work to be funny? And a lot of it with humor is it works on expectations. And without those expectations, such as we saw here, especially when you see the gentleman with the board, you already know what's going to happen. You can see it ahead of time. That expectation is there. Sometimes it is satisfied, and other times it is subverted. That's a form of humor. That's called incongruity. So let's now break down the weekly content. I've been going now for almost half an hour, so we're just going to go through and take a look. So the first week, we're just doing the course introduction and expectations. So here are the readings, pretty straightforward. Chapter 1, pages 8 to 11. So not really a whole lot. So we're just going to work through that. Next week, and again, the modules, really, I like to just call them modules because we do have a week off, I believe the beginning of March, I think. Again, lots of time before that actually happens. But think of them in terms of modules. So module 2, we're going to take a look at the origins and evolution of humor. Because it does have an evolution, it does evolve over time. And I've already mentioned a couple of things about how humor is quite different today than it was even 40, 50 years ago, or even 100 years ago. So it does have a particular evolution. But we're going to look at the origins of it as well. And a really important question is humor an emotion? This is the question that I will leave open to individual students to debate whether or not they think it is. Because it can be an emotion in the sense that humor and laughter gives us a sense of elation and uplifting. It makes us feel good. And then others will say, well, no, it's not an emotion, because what it's doing is it's an intellectual language game, or it's an intellectual exercise. So it operates at a higher level than humor. So again, let's look at both sides of the argument, and I will leave it up to you to decide which one is the one that is appropriate for you, because both are valid. And here we're going to talk about origins and evolution, pages 12 to 20. Again, the readings are not very long. The chapters are very short and very to the point. Module 3, then we start going back and we look at our kind of history of humor. And no big surprise, the earliest ideas about humor came from Aristotle and Plato. Right, and they were writing in the 400 and 300 BC, so a very long time ago. And Cicero, a Roman philosopher, writing about 100 BC. So they're all well before the birth of Christ. But even that early, we have some very interesting ideas about philosophy, some of which have lasted for a very, very long time and are still relevant, still being used. We've got Plato that is not a big fan of humor. He's not a big fan of poets either, but he certainly is not a fan of humor and comedy. He thinks it's very lowbrow. We should always be aiming for reason and aiming for the high things. And he looks at humor as a kind of really sort of a lowbrow view of the world. Aristotle, who was Plato's student, says, well, yeah, but, you know, we can laugh at things for their very absurdity. They're just their sheer strangeness sometimes. And Aristotle presents to us for the first time the idea of incongruity, things that are mismatched, that sit together for some reason. And that is the source of the humor. Cicero also talks about the same sort of thing of incongruity, language games. So even these kinds of what we consider to be contemporary ideas actually have a very early, early beginning. Module 4, we start talking about the first versions of what are called superiority theories of humor. This is this notion that the person that is uttering the humorous words, the comedic words, has a sense of superiority over the individual that is discussed in the joke. So superiority theories, dumb blonde jokes, for example, or Newfie jokes in Canada, these are examples of superiority theory, because the notion is that the person that is uttering these words feels higher than the people that he's discussing, that he or she is discussing. But we look at both Plato, who originates this idea, and then we look at Descartes, Hobbes, and Bergson. So Descartes is writing in roughly the 1600s, Hobbes around the same time. So we we jump about 1500 years. But Descartes and Hobbes have these very particular ideas about superiority theories. Now, when I discuss them, and I want to be clear, these philosophers, including Plato, are not talking about them in a positive way. They're saying that this is what's bad about humor, is people do feel superior over others because they're laughing at them, not with them. So René Descartes, Thomas Hobbes, Henri Bergson, all present various versions, different ideas that can be under the category of superiority theories. So they're not saying it is a good thing. They're saying quite the opposite. Now, the first reflection essay will be due at the end of Module 4. In this case, it's the date will be Sunday, February the 7th. So I just wanted to write that down. Then we move on to Module 5, and we talk about incongruity theories of humor. And Immanuel Kant, Arthur Schopenhauer, Soren Kierkegaard. I don't know if you've ever taken philosophy before. Don't worry about who these people are. We're going to get to that. But these three philosophers, writing, again, in a very short period of time, roughly the late 1700s and throughout the 1800s, incongruity theory of humor is this notion of mismatched things. And the mismatchedness, we'll say, is what is actually humorous. The idea of talking animals, right? Very incongruous. But that is funny in itself because we don't expect it. So the unexpectedness of humor, when we talk about something, as we saw, for example, in the Monty Python skit, a couple times we could see what was coming up. And in other times, nope, it was subverted. So our expectations of something are subverted. And it's based on what we expect to happen. We're basing it on reality. We're basing it on previous behaviors of people or things or animals. And all of a sudden, something completely different happens. That's incongruity theory of humor. So it is a particular worldview that looks at the world rather humorously. And although Aristotle presents it in 300 BC, it's revisited in the 1800s by Kant, Schopenhauer, and Kierkegaard. Now, the last theory we're going to look at before the midterm is what's called relief theory. And here we start talking about the psychology of humor. Now, Herbert Spencer, Sigmund Freud, and Mikhail Bakhtin offer different kinds of relief theories. And again, what is important to remember is each one of the thinkers all throughout the course will have slightly different variations on this kind of general idea. Here, for example, is particularly important because Spencer and Freud talk about relief theory as a kind of safety valve, because our minds work to sort of suppress irrational thoughts or rude thoughts or thoughts that are sexual in nature, for example. And we kind of have a lid that holds that down tight. And Spencer and Freud believe that a healthy mind is a mind that can allow that lid to open up just a little bit periodically, depending on the context, and allow some of those illicit thoughts, those irrational thoughts to kind of slip out. And they can slip out sometimes in what's called a Freudian slip. Right? That's what that means, is coming out and saying something that you're really trying hard to avoid saying, and you blurt it out because you're trying so hard to not say it. So relief theory is looking at how humor sometimes can escape some of those kind of shutters that we have to close down, right? The lid that we hold over top of some of these illicit thoughts. Sometimes they can be released temporarily, and usually it is within a context that is considered to be humorous. When we go to a comedy club, we expect that people will be funny. We hope they're going to be funny. But when somebody's just walking down the street and just saying rude things, we're thinking maybe there's something else wrong with them. So context has a lot to do with what is considered funny. Bakhtin, on the other hand, looks at the same kind of idea, this notion of a lid not put on people, but more so put on society. Right, those social norms that we normally follow through, social mores, we sometimes call them, that allow society to function. Because without them, every day would be a whole new adventure and very tiring after a while. But Bakhtin has this idea that sometimes it's healthy for society to lift that lid and let some of those things that are suppressed, let them out temporarily. And again, it's done always within a context. Bakhtin is the not the inventor, but the creator of this linguistic form called the carnivalesque. And the carnivalesque is this world turned upside down. In other words, the world of the irrational that is usually held down under that lid is let free, right? It's let go. And people behave in ways that are very different that they normally would in society, but for only a period of time. And then once that period is over and the carnival is over, people go back to normal. So it is an interesting idea about the health, the mental health of society, the degree to which we're allowed to do this. So those are the relief theories I'm going to look at, with Spencer and Freud looking at the individual and Bakhtin looking at society, right? The society in which the individual lives. As you can see at the bottom, second reflection essay is due on the 21st. So that's 2 weeks later. And in the following week, we have the online midterm test. Now, again, we're talking now, this is 7 weeks into the course. So we'll talk more about it, but just very briefly, the online test, just like the in-class test, is made up of four different sections. There's two sections that have some flexibility. The very first one is true-false questions. There will be 10 of those, and they're just that, true-false. The second section is called identify and explain. And here you'll have a choice of something like 12 or 15 different terms. And all I want you to do is answer five. And answer five and give me, first of all, what the term means. And if possible, an example of either a video that we may have seen or some mention of it in the book or in this case, it's not class, but in the Zoom meetings or even my lectures. But some example of this particular term. What does it mean? What does incongruity mean? Oh, it means something that is mismatched. For example, you know, a talking dog. There you go, two out of two. So that it's as simple as that. So the second, identify and explain, you only have to answer five out of as many as 12 to 15. Third section, that will be short answer questions. And those can be answered in two or three sentences. There's five of them worth 3 points each, so a total of 15. And in the last section, which we're just going to call simply longer answer. If I say essay question, people freak out, and it's not really an essay question because you can write it in point form if you like. It's not an English essay or it's not an English class. But here you have a choice of four different questions. And then again, just answer one. So we'll talk about it some more. But the test material, what I've done is I've set up both midterm test review slides as well as the final exam slides. And the slides, what I've done is I've taken each of the modules and I've created one page. So one page of notes for each of the half dozen modules and just read through that. And that is going to be your source for your answers. So that's essentially it. So the online midterm test and the final test is going to be based basically in the same way. So now once we finish the midterm, we go back to the material, and here now we start looking at ethics and something else. And so the first one, module 8, is humor and ethics. And here we start talking about, we start talking about the relationship of the speaker and the listener. Is it, again, a relationship of superiority, right? Are the two individuals now going to laugh at someone else? But by the same token, what if a community, what if a subgroup within a community have their own humor and they bond over a common enemy, for example, or a common situation? So what are the ethical issues relating to that? So humor ethics, clearly more important now than ever, but we're going to sort of dip into that first and then we'll return to it at the very tail end when we look at humor and ethics and postmodernism. So module 9, now again, another issue that would be surprising on the surface, but humor and religion do have a strong relationship. We're going to look at it in terms of Christianity, Judaism, Buddhism, Islam. And here we're going to see how, for example, the nature of humor is such that we can entertain in our heads two different things. We can hold in our heads what we are seeing in front of us, what is, but also hold in the back of our minds what should be. So we are able to separate two different things and have them coexist without any trouble because we're looking at something. And of course, the humor is that discrepancy, right? That incongruity between what we know should be and what's actually going on. Now, religion works in much the same way. We can look at the real world, and we can look at the beauty of nature, for example. We can look around and we can see, if you're religious-minded, that there's great beauty in the world. And of course, there has to be a creator that has created this perfection in the world today. So what you're doing is, again, holding two different thoughts in your head. You're holding the reflection of the world around you, the worldview of that reality in front of you, and seeing behind it or beyond it. And that's where the religious content is usually found, right? So you're looking and you have ideas about reality. So the same kind of thing is happening in humor. The reality of what is versus what informs the humor, which is what should be going on. We shouldn't have talking animals. We shouldn't have things that float in the air that typically fall to the ground. So we find it not unnerving, but we find it funny. So human religion, they do have relationships which are quite strong. And here at the end of module 9, the third reflection essay will be due March 21st. So as we carry on, module 10, now we're going to start sort of what I call the slightly more difficult stuff, but not difficult once we have had a chance to scaffold this material and we have our different types of theories, superiority, incongruity, relief, play, carnivalesque, and so on. Now we're going to look at something that is much more topical, which is the postmodern world. First, we try to identify what that is, and then we're going to look at what postmodernism means in terms of humor. And here we're going to talk a little bit about continental philosophy. We're going to talk about some of the different thinkers, Terry Eagleton, some of the notions about postmodernism. Here you can see the chapters are slightly longer, but what I've done is I've divided modules 10 and 11. I've taken the full chapter and sort of broken it in half because there is a lot of material to look at. So as you can see, postmodernism parts 1 and 2. And here we talk about Thomas Pynchon, Russell Brand, Ilan Csikszentmihalyi, a whole range of different people. And one of the things we talk about here is the role, for example, of philosophy in humor, how you can wax philosophically. If you've ever seen anything that Russell Brand has done fairly recently, say over the last couple of years, he really is in this realm of talking not just in the abstract, but using humor to talk about the big topics, the big metaphysical topics, you know, existence, being, oneness with the universe. And they don't have to necessarily be religious, but he's talking about existence, but he does it in a humorous way. So he really has broadened, he's widened his worldview to include much more than just, you know, hey, what is it about airline food? Ha ha, like, okay, it's been done, right? Time to move on. So postmodernism and humor, we're going to look at those particular topics. And then the last two modules, 12 and 13, is what I call laughter at the limits of understanding. How far can we go with humor? And so, again, in two parts, the fourth reflection essay is also due at the end of module 12, April 11th. And laughter at the limits of understanding is exactly that. How far can we push humor in terms of its absurdity, of its incongruity, of its superiority, maybe? But the limits of understanding also have to do with, again, our relationship to the world, to society, to each other, to others who are not like us, whether that's based on gender, whether that's based on race or color of one's skin. All these issues become much more important. And some of the different thinkers, Jean-Luc Nancy, Charles Baudelaire, Friedrich Nietzsche, Simon Critchley, Helmut Plessner. Again, don't worry about the names. These are simply the people that I draw from and discuss their ideas. But some hopefully thought-provoking stuff here, because it really is, it's topical to say the least. And finally, the last one, Laughter at the Limits of Understanding, part 2. And where's the, okay, the book I forgot, the Noel Carroll book. That's kind of where I take the most of the ideas from, because Carroll really looks in depth at some of the issues that have to do with humor today, right? What are those limits in terms of what we can get away with? Just because you're talking in a comedy club, are there limits? Is everything off limits, or is everything sort of open for discussion? And what if somebody decides to push back, right? What's that going to look like? So here we're going to talk about exactly that, how far we can go with humor in this day and age. And the readings, of course, for McDonald, 123 to 128, fairly short. But don't worry about the Noel Carroll book. These are just simply the books that I used to create the modules. But the John McDonald book, or not John, the Paul McDonald book is the one that is the required text. And then finally, we have our online final test at the end of module 14. And again, it will be available from April 19th to 25th. So you will have a period of time to write it. It doesn't have to be written at the same time, but once it starts, you have 2 hours to complete it. And again, the same thing, you've got the final test review slides, you've got the review sheets. We can talk a little bit about the test as we get within the last couple of weeks or so, but we will finish it up and be able to take a look at this in more detail. But we'll do the same thing with the midterm as well as we get a little bit closer. So that's essentially it. The last thing I want to show you, this is a little three or four minute video that kind of talks a little bit about some of the ideas that I've discussed, again, in a very sort of abstract and hopefully humorous way. And so that will be it. I will say bye once this is done. And we will see each other. Hang on, get my sheet here. Okay, we have a scheduled Zoom meeting for Phil 1013 from noon to 1 p.m. On Tuesday, so January the 12th. And the reason why we need to have that as soon as possible is because we don't have a scheduled hour. We have to come up with that scheduled hour as quickly as possible. So the more people show up, the more we can have a quick debate over what we need to do, and we'll hammer that down as quickly as we can before we move on. So I will leave you this with this sort of thought-provoking video here. And once it's done, we'll see each other again on Tuesday.
What's the definition of comedy? Thinkers and philosophers from Plato and Aristotle to Hobbes, Freud, and beyond, including anyone misguided enough to try to explain a joke, have pondered it, and no one has settled it. You're lucky you found this video to sort it out. To define comedy, you should first ask why it seems comedy defies definition. The answer is simple. Comedy is the defiance of definition, because definitions sometimes need defiance. Consider definition itself. When we define, we use language to set borders around a thing that we've perceived in the whirling chaos of existence. We say what the thing means and fit that in a system of meanings. Chaos becomes cosmos. The universe is translated into a cosmological construct of knowledge. And let's be honest, we need some logical cosmic order, otherwise we'd have pure chaos. Chaos can be rough, so we build a thing that we call reality. Now think about logic and logos, that tight knot connecting word and truth. And let's jump back to thinking about what's funny, because some people say it's real simple. Truth is funny. It's funny because it's true. But that's simplistic. Plenty of lies are funny. Comedic fiction can be funny. Made-up nonsense gibberish is frequently hilarious. For instance, florp, hysterical. And plenty of truths aren't funny. 2 + 2 truly equals 4, but I'm not laughing just because that's the case. You can tell a true anecdote, but your date may not laugh. So why are some untruths and only some truths funny? How do these laughable truths and untruths relate to that capital T truth, the cosmological reality of facts and definitions? And what makes any of them funny? There's a Frenchman who can help, another thinker who didn't define comedy because he expressly didn't want to. Henri Bergson was a French philosopher who prefaced his essay on laughter by saying he wouldn't define the comic because it's a living thing. He argued laughter has a social function to destroy mechanical inelasticity in people's attitudes and behavior. Someone doing the same thing over and over, or building up a false image of himself and the world, or not adapting to reality by just noticing the banana peel on the ground. This is automatism, ignorance of one's own mindless rigidity, and it's dangerous, but also laughable, and comic ridicule helps correct it. The comic is a kinetic vital force, or élan vital, that helps us adapt. Bergson elaborates on this idea to study what's funny about all sorts of things, but let's stay on this. At the base of this concept of comedy is contradiction between vital adaptive humanity and dehumanized automatism. A set system that claims to define reality might be one of those dehumanizing forces that comedy tends to destroy. Now, let's go back to Aristotle. Not Poetics, where he drops a few thoughts on comedy. No, metaphysics. The fundamental law of non-contradiction, the bedrock of logic. Contradictory statements are not at the same time true. If A is an axiomatic statement, it can't be the case that A and the opposite of A are both true. Comedy seems to live here, to subsist on the illogic of logical contradiction and its derivatives. We laugh when the order we project on the world is disrupted and disproven, like when the way we all act contradicts truths we don't like talking about, or when strange observations we all make in the silent darkness of private thought are dragged into public by a good stand-up. And when cats play piano, because cats, that are also somehow humans, disrupt our reality. So we don't just laugh at truth, we laugh at the pleasurable, edifying revelation of flaws, incongruities, overlaps, and outright conflicts in the supposedly ordered system of truths we use to define the world and ourselves. When we think too highly of our thinking, when we think things are true just because we all say they're logos and stop adapting, we become the butt of jokes played on us by that wacky little trickster, chaos. Comedy conveys that destructive, instructive playfulness, but has no logical definition because it acts upon our logic, paralogically, from outside its finite borders. Far from having a definite definition, it has an infinite infinition. And the infinition of comedy is that anything can be mined for comedy. Thus, all definitions of reality, especially those that claim to be universal, logical, cosmic, capital T, truth, become laughable.
Okay, so there you go. That is a very highfalutin, sort of strict version of comedy. We're not going to talk so much about comedy, although that is the content that we're going to discuss. We're going to talk more so about humor, which is the way in which we laugh, the reasons why we laugh at something. And that short video does touch on some of the ideas, especially the incongruity, right? The notion that we use language to construct a world that we all agree is what it is. And because it's only an agreement, there are people that see the world differently and they are ready to twist and turn and manipulate that world for humorous effect. And that's what humor is. So for humorous effects, that's what we're going to look at more so than anything else in this course. So we're almost up to an hour here, 57 and a half already. So hopefully we'll see each other on Tuesday, at which point we're going to figure out what we're going to do for 1 hour Zoom. But in the meantime, I will see you in a couple of days, and we're going to start on lesson one. So take care.